I got interviewed for the chair in pharmacology at University College. And of course, that's very flattering to be headhunted. And but it wasn't just the flattery. I think I pride, I kid myself, that I liked the idea that maybe in academia I could continue this kind of work without having to think commerce, that we would be able to go look for tools that would interfere with physiological processes. And so that was in my mind when I went to University College. And I did a lot of interesting things there. I learned to teach pharmacology, which I didn't do very well, but I did my best. I learned that my staff, my faculty, there was about 12 of them, none of them had ever done medicine, and all loved to give lectures talking about medical subjects. And I thought this was preposterous. And so I wanted to change the course, and I wanted to teach pharmacology as properties of molecules, and nothing to do with medicine, because we don't. But again, that was one of the battles I lost. They loved to talk about all these diseases about which they knew nothing and cared less. But we did some interesting pharmacology. One of the things we worked on was I developed an interest in mathematical modeling of pharmacology, which had started with James Raventos, you may imagine. And so we were able to model all kinds of things, like why DCI and the guanidino analogue of histamine, why they would stimulate on certain preparations and not on others. And this is because they're partial agonists, and partial agonists are dependent on the density of receptors. If the density is very high, you see the agonist activity. If the receptor density is low, then you just see the blocking activity. And then we showed how that if you blocked indirectly, so gastrin releasing histamine, and you block histamine. Now I'm going to amplify this story. I have a beautiful data set which was generated by Mike Parsons. And this shows histamine dose response curves in alone and in the presence of two increasing doses of cimetidine, or metiamide it was, the precursor. So you've got parallel shifts of the dose response curves, which is what theory predicts that you get. When we went to gastrin, well, we didn't use gastrin. We used the commercially available ICI-produced terminal pentapeptide, pentagastrin. And when we did pentagastrin dose response curves, they weren't displayed. First of all, the shape of them was different. Whereas the histamine curves were steep, the pentagastrin curves flat, and they developed an inhibitory action at the top. And when you put increasing doses in, this thing collapsed. So two things. One was we were able mathematically to show that that was precisely what you expect if it's an indirectly acting antagonist. But the other thing was, I remember, and I have the slide I produced, and we did an experiment like showing that if you took maximum stimulated histamine secretion and then put gastrin on top, there was an inhibitory component in gastrin. And so I remember making this little model that gastrin stimulates, like histamine, but also recruits at slightly higher doses an inhibitory action. And what you see is the resultant, hence the shape. And I modeled this reduction in as dose response curves moving in parallel across this inhibitory function. And I really forgot about that until recently. And I'll come back to that if you can just hold that in the memory because of some work I'm going to tell you about. Back to University College. My passion to get chemistry, medicinal chemistry, going in a university failed. I managed to get them to start an undergraduate degree in medicinal chemistry, which was not a very good course, because by this time the university was running the unit system, and all you could do was cobble together units, and it was just not a very good course. But it's popular. People liked it because it seemed to be more directly utility orientated than just pure chemistry. But what I wanted was to build a floor on the top of the chemistry department, which would, I wanted to get the money for that, where I'd get half and the university would get half, but I'd have my dedicated chemists. Well, 4 years I failed. I never got the money, never got the chemistry. And so my dream of medicinal chemistry in academia, not driven by commerce, failed.